Good morning, everyone. Welcome to worship to HTK this morning on this, the fourth Sunday of the Advent season, and a very special welcome to those who are joining us online this morning. As is our usual practice, my acolyte has just sat down, but I'm going to get her to stand up again with her pretty silver shoes and come forward and light the Advent candle for us. So let's continue. Last Sunday, we lit the candle of love. We lighted and the candles of hope and peace again, as we remember that Christ, who was born in Bethlehem, will come again to judge the world and bring it everlasting peace, hope, and love. So the fourth candle of Advent is the candle of joy. When the angel Gabriel told Mary that a special child will be born to her, she was filled with joy. She sang a song that began with the words, "My soul magnifies the Lord. My spirit rejoices in God my Saviour." Just as the birth of Jesus gave great joy to his mother, so his presence in the world gave joy to those who had none before. He healed them and gave them hope and peace when they believed in him. From hope, peace, and love grows joy. We light the candle of joy to remind us that when Jesus is born in us, we have joy, and that through him there will be everlasting joy on earth. Joy is like a light shining in a dark place. As we look at this candle, we celebrate the joy we find in Jesus Christ. Thank you, God, for the joy you give us. We ask that as we wait for all your promises to come true and for Christ to come again, that you would remain present with us. Help us today and every day to worship you and to hear your word, and to do your will by sharing your joy with each other. We ask it in the name of the one who was born in Bethlehem. Amen. So we're going to have a series of songs to begin with. So let's stand and begin with "Joy to the World."
Thank you. watch their flocks by night, all seated on the ground. The angel of the Lord came down, and glory shone around. Not, he said, for mighty dread had seized their troubled minds. Glad tidings of great joy I bring to you and all mankind. To you in David's town this day is born of David's line. The Savior who is Christ the Lord, and this shall be the sign. Heavenly babe you there shall find, to human view displayed, and meanly wrapped in swaddling bands, and in a manger laid. Thus spake the seraph, and forthwith appeared a shining throng of angels praising God, who thus addressed their joyful song. All glory be to God on high, and to the earth be peace. Goodwill henceforth from heaven to men begin and never cease.
Hello, what's your name? Indigo, I'm David. You know what that is? A barn. And who's in the barn? Where? Right there, the baby. Who else? Who else is there? The donkey? Where? Oh. Poking his head over the back. Oh. And what does this scene tell us? when Jesus was born. So when do we celebrate that? At Christmas. And when's Christmas? 25th of December. And how far away is that? 6 days. Six more sleeps till Christmas. And what are you doing for Christmas, Indy? Is that going to be good? What are you getting for Christmas? Oh, she doesn't know what she's getting for Christmas. Well, that's pretty normal, isn't it? People give us things which they think we need, and sometimes we don't think we need that. Like a new pair of socks.
You can't wear socks and sandals.
No, you can't wear socks and sandals.
My dad can.
Tell your dad.
He's 85.
Oh, he's 85. He can get away with it. So what do we do the day after Christmas? Play with all our presents. And then the day after that, eat what's left over.
Eat Christmas ham for 3 weeks.
Eat Christmas ham for 3 weeks. Is that what you do? No? Well, life gets back to normal pretty quickly, doesn't it? After Christmas. But what's the most important thing you've ever done? You don't know. I bet you it'll take them a lot longer to think of what they don't know either, because they've had more years to think about it. Well, the reason I ask that question is because when we look at this scene, that really is the most important thing that has ever happened in the history of the world, the birth of Jesus. And we celebrate that birth every year, but then we just get on with our lives again. Your sister's birthday? Oh, sister's birthday and dad's birthday is just after Christmas. Oh, he's before, and she's in January. Life just goes on, doesn't it? And yet, when Jesus came, God was fulfilling all his promises that he'd ever made, and gave us some more promises. So that when we think about Christmas, we think about, hey, God did an amazing thing for us. So that it's not just something we celebrate once a year. It's something that tells us about the whole purpose of us in the world. It is the most important thing. It affects who we are today, what's going to happen to us tomorrow. So, as we celebrate Christmas, let's not just fill our bellies full of ham for 3 weeks. Let's not just go on with life, but let's remember, hey, this is the most important thing that has ever happened in the history of the world. Let's celebrate what God's done for us. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for our Lord Jesus as we celebrate his birth this Christmas. Bless us, Father, to celebrate what you've done for us every day of our lives. For we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Let's stand for the greeting of peace. And so the Lord be with you.
Also with you.
We are the body of Christ. And the peace of the Lord be always with you. Let's share the peace with each other in the COVID-friendly way. Hey, you may be seated as Andrew shares the readings for this morning.
The psalm this morning is Song of Mary. My soul proclaims the greatness of the Lord. My spirit rejoices in God, my Saviour, who has looked with favour on his lowly servant. For from this day, all generations will call me blessed. The Almighty has done great things for me, and holy is his name. God has mercy on those who fear him from generation to generation. The Lord has shown strength with his arm and scattered the proud with their conceit, casting down the mighty from their thrones and lifting the lowly. God has filled the hungry with good things and sent the rich away empty. He has come to the aid of his servant Israel to remember the promise of mercy, the promise made to our forebears, to Abraham and his children forever. Glory to God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, as in the beginning, so now, and forever. Amen. This morning's gospel reading comes from Luke chapter 1, verses 39 to 45. And if you have a Bible, it's 1:03 in that. At that time, Mary got ready and hurried to a town in the hill country of Judea, where she entered Zechariah's home and greeted Elizabeth. When Elizabeth heard Mary's greeting, the baby leapt in her womb, and Mary was filled with the Holy Spirit. In a loud voice, she exclaimed, "Blessed are you among women, and blessed is the child you will bear. But why am I so favored that the mother of my Lord should come to me? As soon as the sound of your greeting reached my ears, the baby in my womb leapt for joy. Blessed is she who has believed that what the Lord has said to her will be accomplished." This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. Yep.
Thank you. As I said earlier, six sleeps to go. Are you excited? Yes, they say. Yes, we're really excited. Oh, you got your presents yesterday. You really are blessed. Well, it does become a bit routine, doesn't it? Christmas. We celebrate it every year. We try and work out how on earth are we going to gather together with Uncle Joe, with Grandma and Grandpa. How are we going to get everybody together and make sure that we don't have any arguments this Christmas? And then we breathe a great sigh of relief on Boxing Day when everybody's gone home and there's lots still to eat for another 3 weeks, is it? Another 3 weeks of ham. But as I also said in the kids' talk, this event that we symbolise in this sort of image, this event is the pinnacle of human history. In this event, God shows us exactly what he's doing with us, who he is, and how he looks upon us. When we read in the scriptures this event, we recognize that it's not just a scene in history. It's not just an event. It is something that God has prepared for long before it happened. And at the time that it happened, it wasn't just Joseph and Mary traveling back to Joseph's hometown for this Roman census and that Mary gave birth to Jesus there. It's not just that. You see, if we read back in Luke's gospel, there's an angel who speaks to Mary. In fact, it's the angel Gabriel who stands in the presence of God. It's this angel who has come to this young woman, a teenager of no import. She wasn't someone famous. She wasn't born in a royal household. She says herself that she was of humble circumstances. And yet an angel comes and speaks to her. When that angel came, Mary's reaction was not, "Oh, wow, isn't this fantastic? Look at what God's doing for me." No. Mary's reaction when the angel came and spoke to her was that she was afraid. The angel says to her, "Don't be afraid, Mary. Don't be afraid." I can tell you, if I was somewhere on my own and an angel appeared to me, I'd be a bit nervous. I think it'd be a scary thing. But this angel says to Mary, don't be afraid. You have found favor with God. You have found favor with God. Mary found favor with God because God chose her. Not because she was someone famous or someone from a rich family, but simply because God said, "This is the one I want." Someone from humble circumstances. And Gabriel's message to Mary is that you will be with child and give birth to a son, and you are to give him the name Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. Well, I reckon if she was afraid when she first saw the angels, she would be starting to, she would be getting a whole lot more nervous at this point. The angel goes on, "The Lord God will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over the house of Jacob forever. His kingdom will have no end." Can you imagine the thoughts that are going through Mary's mind at this point? How can this be? And that's exactly what she says to the angel. "How will this be, since I'm a virgin?" And the angel answered, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. So the Holy One to be born will be called the Son of God." Imagine this teenage girl of humble circumstances, what is going through her mind now? That she is going to bear the Son of God. The angel says to her, "Look, I know all this sounds a bit unbelievable, but your relative Elizabeth, in her old age, has become pregnant. She's now 6 months pregnant." The angel is pointing out to Mary, believe it. This is what God has decided. This is what God is doing. Look, he's already done something with your relative Elizabeth. Don't be afraid. Trust that God knows what he's doing. Believe that all this is possible. I've certainly run across people in my life who say, "Virgin birth? Are you kidding? It's just not possible." Well, of course, it's God. All things are possible with God. And I reckon it's actually a no-brainer. You know, God who created the universe, surely he can cause a virgin to become pregnant. He is God. With him, all things are possible. And so Mary responds to the angel Gabriel and says, I am the servant of the Lord. May it be to me as you have said. And the angel left her. But Mary took the opportunity to go and visit Elizabeth. And she entered the house and called out a greeting. And when Elizabeth heard Mary's greeting, the baby in Elizabeth leapt for joy. And Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Spirit. This child that Elizabeth is carrying is to be John the Baptist, who again, an angel had spoken to his father, telling him that Elizabeth would bear a child in her old age. Dear old Zechariah didn't believe it, and so was made silent until after John was born. But the angel had said to Zechariah, John the Baptist's father, this child, will be filled with the Holy Spirit in his mother's womb. So when this child, still just 6 months in the womb, hears the greeting of Mary, he leaps for joy within Elizabeth's womb. And Elizabeth recognizes what's going on, that she too becomes at that point filled with the Spirit and declares to Mary, blessed are you among women, and blessed is the child you will bear. But why am I so favored that the mother of my Lord should come to me? As soon as the sound of your greeting reached my ears, the baby in my womb leapt for joy. Blessed is she who has believed what the Lord has said, that it will be accomplished. What thoughts are running through Mary's head at this point? The child, unborn, leapt for joy when it heard my greeting. Elizabeth recognizes that Mary is carrying my Lord. Mary is about to declare the glory of God. As she hears Elizabeth's response, Elizabeth's telling of what happened when Mary arrived, Mary goes into the Song of Mary, as we know it, the Magnificat, and she says, my soul glorifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God my Saviour. What we see is that Mary recognises she is no special person. She is someone from humble circumstances. She is someone even who needs a Saviour. She, like you and me, is a sinful person. Mary, the Mother of God, recognizes God as her Savior because she is a sinful person. And so she has the experience with the angel. She hears from her relative Elizabeth what has happened as Mary has come. And she thinks, what is going on? She rejoices in what God is doing, glorifies the Lord, rejoices in her Saviour, because he has been mindful of her humble state, the humble state of his servant, as she describes herself. And she says, from now on, all generations will call me blessed. And of course, that's what we do. Even today, over 2,000 years later, we still refer to this teenage girl as the Blessed Virgin Mary. Of course, we rightly call her that because she was the bearer of God. Amazing, isn't it? This child within her is hers and he is God's. So she says, people are going to call me blessed for generations to come because the Mighty One has done great things for me. Holy is his name. So as she reflects upon all of this that's been happening, her attention is drawn not to herself. Oh, God's chosen me. No. Her attention is drawn to God. She glorifies, she rejoices in God. She says to us that his name is holy because of all of this that he's done. And in those first few verses of this song of Mary, she recounts what has been happening to her, but from then on, she talks about how God has been dealing with humanity. His mercy, she says, extends to those who fear him from generation to generation. Not those who tremble in their boots at the thought of, I'm going to face God. No. To those who have a healthy respect, a love for God. His mercy extends to those. He has performed mighty deeds with his arm. He has scattered those who are proud in their inmost thoughts. Notice the contrast between the humility, the humble circumstances of Mary and what God's attitude is to those who are proud. With his mighty arm, he scatters them. All of this actually points us to how we should behave before God. Not in pride, not with some sense of, well, I'm going to live my life the way I think I should live it. But in a real sense of humility, I am a sinner. I seek to live before God under his mercy. Because those who are proud, God scatters. In fact, Mary goes on and tells us, he has brought down rulers from their thrones, but he's lifted up the humble. And we see that in her, Mary herself, that God lifts up the humble. He's filled the hungry with good things, but has sent the rich away empty. Now, there's nothing wrong with being rich. She talks about Abraham in the next couple of verses, and he was a very wealthy man. The attitude, what the issue is, what is one's attitude? To say, well, I'm rich, look at what I've achieved, is not to have the humility that God expects of us. And if that's our attitude, I've done it all, I don't need God, God says, away. Mary tells us that God has helped his servant Israel, remembering to be merciful to Abraham and his descendants forever, even as he promised our fathers. This event, this day in Bethlehem that we celebrate every year, is the pinnacle of what God is doing in the world. Mary looks back thousands of years and talks about God's promises to the father Abraham and his descendants after him. She recognizes that in this child, there is the fulfillment of the promises. He will sit on the throne of his father, David. But at the same time, as Mary reminds us of those promises of God, helping us to look back and saying, yes, look at what God's done, she also throws our attention forward. The promises that God gave to Abraham continue into the future, so that this song of praise of Mary and what God is doing at this point in history brings together for us everything, past, present, and future. So that as we celebrate Christmas, our attention is turned to God, who throughout history has been working towards this event, and from this event holds our future in his hands as he continues to fulfill the promises made to Abraham and his offspring forever. So, yes, six sleeps to go to open those presents, to eat that food, to sleep it off, and to get up and go on with our lives. But let's not do that. At this Christmas, let's remember what God has done way, way before this event, fulfilling his promises through the years, looking forward to the continuing fulfillment of his promises. Let's this Christmas look to God as Mary did, in our humble circumstances, that our lives may be lived for this one who is the pinnacle of history. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your Son, born of the Blessed Virgin Mary. Thank you, Father, that you chose Mary from humble circumstances to be the Mother of God. Bless us, Father, at this Christmas as we remember that amazing occasion, that we may remember the way you have prepared for it, fulfilling your promises to Abraham and the generations since, and looking forward to you continuing to fulfill your promises to bring us to that day when Jesus comes again. Bless us, Father, this Christmas to honour you in our lives wholeheartedly, for we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Yes, thank you, David, for your word to us at 8 and at 10. We're truly blessed by it. I wish I could stand up and preach with no notes, so it's wonderful to be able to see someone who can. Let's stand and say together the affirmation of faith. I believe I need a shepherd, because I am sometimes timid and other times overconfident, because I often don't know the best path, yet pretend I do, because I rush into dead ends or lead others into hazardous places, because my brightest ideas are seamed with darkness, because the things I crave may not be what is good for me. I need a shepherd. I believe in Jesus, the best possible shepherd. His wisdom leads me to the optimum opportunities. His word comforts me when I'm anxious or afraid. His arm steadies me when I feel weary and heavy laden. His wounded body displays the cost of my rescue. I believe in Jesus, the best possible shepherd. I believe that I do not find him, but he finds me, that I am under his care by virtue of sheer grace. The love he gives me is to be shared with others, that he treasures my name and prepares a place for me, that his fold transfixes earth and heaven. I trust Jesus, the good shepherd. Amen.
I'm going to share a couple of prayers from a book of prayers that I got just before I was ordained, which is just over 40 years ago, I think. Can't quite remember it. They're by Frank Cahoon, and he was a parish priest in the UK, and this was given to me as a gift from the people of St. George's at Reservoir in Melbourne. And I've got a flurry there. Cynthia, Ian, Thomas, Rosalie. So it's lovely to have those memories in this prayer book as I'm sharing a couple of those prayers. This is for the fourth Sunday in Advent. Joy and peace. O Lord God, who by thy holy apostle has taught us always to rejoice in thee and to be anxious for nothing, grant, we beseech thee, that making our requests known to thee, we may be partakers of the peace that passes all understanding, which thou hast promised us in thy Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. A prayer for the preparation for Christmas. Grant us, we beseech thee, Almighty God, that the solemn feast of our redemption, which is now at hand, may help us both in this present life and the furthest towards the attaining of thy eternal joy, into which we is to come through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Also, we're coming from Tasmania. Many years ago, we were shocked this week to see that accident that occurred in Devonport. And my grandparents lived in Devonport, and I know the city well, and it is hurting very much. So we pray for the people of Devonport, people of Tasmania, for the parents of those children who have died, and for the whole of Australia, as represented by our Prime Minister yesterday at the flower memorial for those children. We give thanks for this land and the diversity of its peoples. Grant that we may so honour one another that all may be enriched by our common heritage and freed from despair, poverty and exclusion. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for the church and its mission. As David has shared with us the importance of Christmas and the holiness, and how Mary felt in her being granted that joy of giving birth to the Christ child. We pray for this diocese of South East Queensland, for our Archbishop Philip, for our parish here, HTK, for Steve and Glenda. We give thanks for the good news of salvation for all people. Strengthen us for our work in the world. Empower your church to proclaim the gospel of in service, word and sacrament. Unite in the truth all who confess your name, that we may live together in love to your glory. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Let us pray for ourselves and our community. We give thanks for the fellowship of the communities in which we live and work. We commend to your keeping ourselves and each other, our families, those with whom we work and learn, and our friends. Enable us by your Spirit to live in love for you and for one another. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for those who need. We thank you, Lord, that we are able to help those who have needs throughout the year with our ministry of food and meals. We give thanks to you, our God, that you are the God who brings mercy and wholeness. Comfort and heal, we pray, all who are in sorrow, need, sickness, or any other trouble. Especially at this time, Lord, the people of Australia, Tasmania, and more importantly, Devonport, and the families of those who have lost their young children. Give to those who care for them wisdom, patience and gentleness, and to us all your peace. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We give thanks for the faithful departed, for those who have gone before us over this last 12 months. We give you thanks for your servants in every age. Grant that we, with all your saints, may be brought to a joyful resurrection and the fulfilment of your kingdom. And as we conclude these prayers, let us say together the words our Saviour taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, as we forgive those who trespass against us, and lead us from harm. The power and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
So let us stand and share with the online viewers the grace as we conclude our online streaming. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore. Amen. And we sing now Silent Night. Our service next Sunday is at 9 a.m, a lessons and carol service, and that was the only Christmas service that will be live streamed. So God bless.